And so this notion of ableism simply highlights sort of the presupposition, I think, that most people without disabilities read the Bible in a certain way. And the way we read the Bible is that we don't oftentimes observe the role that disability plays in the Bible. Why? Because we don't think too much about it. You know, it's not in our daily horizon. We're not discomforted by it. We don't have any negative experiences related to it. So it's sort of kind of, you know, out of sight, out of mind. And as a result, when we read the Bible, even something as mundane, if you will, as that, that doesn't, you know, those things that refer to disability don't often register. Or if they do, we sort of dismiss them or we overlook their significance because, again, we don't have a perspective that is informed by those sets of experiences.
That's good.
The physical challenges are almost the least of their worries. I mean, a person who was born blind, let's say, and has sort of gotten along just fine, you know, without it most of their lives, they still have to deal with the attitudes that people have and the assumptions that people make about people with blindness, and those oftentimes are the more hurtful sides of life with disability than the fact that someone maybe just can't see. Word starts getting around, you know, a lot of times pastors say, well, the reason why our church isn't as accessible with this or that, you know, physical accommodation or what have you, is because we don't have people with disabilities in our church. Duh.
They're everywhere.
We don't have people with disabilities in our church because they ain't welcomed in our churches.
Mm-hmm.
Because we don't have a mentality that says something like, that says something beyond, well, you know, we'll tolerate you.
Mm.
Right?
Yeah.
And we need to adopt this mentality that says something like, we're all in need of God, and people with disabilities are no more, no less, and we need to have communities that can embrace all of their gifts. And the challenges, just like you and I embrace each other's gifts and challenges. I mean, you know, neither of us are perfect, and we manage to somehow put up with one another, you know, without too much of a trouble. But the point would be that, you know, when word starts getting around in our communities that there are churches that actually not only welcome but want to and define themselves by being this inclusive, oh, believe me, you know, people with disabilities oftentimes have to put up with more loneliness, more rejection, more social marginalization. If they start finding out that churches are actually welcoming, they'll be much more, you know, they'll be there. You know, I think the second step we could do once we start making these kinds of first steps is to start connecting with agencies that serve populations with various kinds of disabilities. We need to be very intentional. There are so many different agencies that serve different population groups with people with disabilities. And we, you know, I think... Mm-hmm. And so it's maybe not realistic that a small congregation can be all things to all people in terms of ministering to a whole spectrum of people with disabilities, but maybe we can be specialized and maybe we can join hands in across communities in our neighborhoods and so on and congregations to serve large groups of people. And then together build these kinds of inclusive churches. I don't know, those are just a couple of suggestions, I think.
That's great.
Across the Bible, and particularly in the New Testament, the ministry of Jesus, we find that Jesus did cure bodies and he, you know, healed bodies and so forth and so on. But I also think, however, that sometimes we have a sort of a more myopic focus on this kind of physical healing that we do forget that healing in the New Testament actually in its broadest and most complete sense refers to, you know, salvation. Right, and so what happens sometimes is that we reduce this salvific healing to a fixing of bodies, and then by doing so we miss out on the fact that salvation involves a lot more than that, and we miss out particularly on the fact that salvation involves not just individuals but salvation involves whole communities and whole people groups, and so I would say two things. Number one, I would say that while I would never discourage anybody from praying for healing for people with disabilities, I do think, first of all, we need to get to know who they are and figure out where they've come from. A lot of times people with disabilities are pushed away from the church because all we want to do is lay hands on them and pray for them to be healed. And from their perspective, they've sort of gotten along fine without our prayers for healing, and that just confirms to them that they're not really welcomed in our communities. If people with disabilities want to pray for healing, I'll be the first one to come alongside them and pray for them. But I think after we do that, we need to be very, very clear that even if God doesn't heal us or cure us physically, that doesn't mean that we're any more or less whole or central to who we are, you know, to the image of God and to what God understands as a whole community.
As we mistakenly put value on capabilities, it also really undermines people as they get ill, as they get older, and if they have accidents, then we've determined that their worth somehow has to do with how capable they are and how able-bodied they are, and instead of, you know, you are a creature that God's made in his image. And I think that people probably don't realize right off the bat that all of that is at stake.
Well, I think you're absolutely right. I mean, and that's just an example of how our living in the world that we do already sort of compromises our perspective, right? Because, I mean, isn't that the way the world defines worth and value economically? By the, our capacity to produce, you know, contribute to the GNP, for example, right? And so people with disabilities that may be less capable of doing that or maybe completely incapable of doing that, you know, if we view them in that way, haven't we already defined people by the way the world defines them? Which is why we need a hermeneutics of suspicion to get underneath this set of assumptions that we have about what really defines the image of God and what really defines value and what really defines, you know, worth. And so, you know, these economic ways that, that we define all of these things, you know, we've so assumed these things that they're so much a part of our mentality that we don't even stop to think about the fact that where did these ideas come from? And how do we challenge these ideas as Christians? Well, part of it is having to get back to the Bible with the help of our friends and a body of Christ that is composed of these, you know, this broad range of diverse voices and perspectives and experiences. Without their voices and their perspectives and their experiences as part of who we are going to be all the more incapable of getting underneath these assumptions that we think are biblical.